Hello, AP students. This is Mrs. Politsky, and I have notes for Chapter 4, Sensation and Perception. And we're going to close up our notes today in Part 3, talking about perceptual ambiguity and distortions. And, you know, one of the goals of perception is to get an accurate fix kind of on the world around us, you know, to recognize those people who are our friends and to be able to make sure we can differentiate them from our foes, or understanding or recognizing things that could be opportunities from those things that could be dangerous. And sometimes our perceptions can be wildly inaccurate. And because we have a tendency to misinterpret some of the things that we're taking in. So we're going to talk a little bit about illusions. And when we talk about the definition of an illusion, this is when your mind decides or deceives you by interpreting a stimulus pattern in a manner that is demonstrably incorrect. And illusions can become more likely when a stimulus is unclear to begin with. So I want to look at the image that we have right here. And some of this is a little bit of understanding figure and ground relationships. But when you look at this illusion, you know, the question is the person looking straight at you, or are you looking at a profile? And what's interesting is how you might flip that image back and forth. There is a tendency to look at maybe the nose and see that as being more on the peripheral. But when you look at the eye, it looks like it's still looking straight at you. So, I mean, this is one of those things that's a little unclear. And so our mind may misinterpret this. Sometimes when elements of an illusion are combined in a way that is a little unusual, it does kind of lead us to being deceived at times. Or when we look for those familiar patterns and they're not exactly there. So looking off to your right here, there is what looks like Snow White. But the question is, can you see the other image that's there? And again, it's kind of a figure ground relationship. And sometimes our eyes, you know, are drawn to one thing opposed to seeing the thing that might not so easily be recognized. And in this case, what looks like a Sherlock Holmes fellow with a pipe in his mouth, you know, that might not necessarily be the thing that you draw your eyes to initially. But as you look at the image, it does kind of eventually manifest itself. So we're going to mention a few things about the Hermann grid, which you see before you. And if you happen to stare at really the boxes on kind of the left-hand corner, or if you start looking at the diagram to the right, you'll notice that there's a tendency that if you look kind of at the center, that there's going to be some fuzzy dots that are going to be kind of manifesting themselves. Or if you look towards the center of the diagram to the right, you might misinterpret those lines that are kind of going along the horizontal side of the grid as being kind of wavy. But the truth is, it's all kind of a misconception here, and we're going to talk about that. But this is an illusion that kind of dates back to a man named Ludomar Hermann, hence the name Hermann grid, back in 1870. And the illusion is characterized by these ghost-like gray blobs at intersections, but disappear when you look directly at the intersection. And so, like, if I do look at the intersections where it's kind of white, there's that tendency not to necessarily see the gray fuzzy dots. But when I look at maybe the center of it, there's a tendency for these dots to be everywhere. And the same goes with the illusion to the right. If I look at maybe one particular line, I might be able to perceive that maybe as being horizontal. But as I look at the rest of them, it's going to be very disjointed. And part of that is because how our receptor cells in our retina are working. For the most part, these cells are very sensitive to the black and white boundaries. And if we stare at it long enough, it kind of inhibits the activity of adjacent cells. And otherwise, what we're seeing is a little bit more than what's actually there. And it has a lot to do with how the receptor cells are interpreting this information and how they're sending it back to the brain. Ambiguous figures, you know, these are images that are capable of more than one interpretation. In a way, there's no really right or wrong answers to this. And so you might see the face in the vase, or in this case, it looks like a cat and a dog, or what might look like the nectar cube off to the right. Your perception will cycle back and forth between these different images. And again, it's dealing with a figure-ground relationship. And it is all a matter of how quickly we can go back and forth. And once we've figured that out, it is actually very easy to do that. The Mueller-Lear illusion. This is an illusion. If you take a look to the bottom right-hand corner, we have a couple of parallel lines, but the arrows kind of lead you to think that maybe one line is longer than the other. But if you look at the bottom here, there's it shows you how the inverted arrowheads make the lower lines appear a little bit longer. And for the most part, the red lines are pretty much the same. Anyway, we unconsciously interpret this illusion as a three-dimensional object instead of the arrowheads. We see the ends as angles that project towards or away from us. What's interesting is a fellow named Richard Gregory back in 1977 went to South Africa and he studied the Zulu, which are a group of people who were native to Africa and that part of Africa. They have a tendency to live in shelters that are a little more circular. And in a way, their world is not as perpendicular as ours. And what he found is that this group of people, the Zulu, did not fall victim to this illusion for some reason. They were able to figure it out and not necessarily be led astray. So in a way, maybe because of the fact that we live in the world that we live in, a lot of 90-degree angles, we're more likely to fall victim to this illusion. A couple of other illusions that you might want to take a look at. We've got the Victor Vasari, his painting known as Gestalt Blue, and M.C. Escher, one of his drawings known as Sky and Water, which actually is probably more like a tessellation that you might see maybe in a geometry class. But what's interesting about maybe Gestalt Blue is the depth reversals. It's kind of a lot like a nectar cube if you think about it. And if you spend a lot of time looking at it, it can be very deceiving, just as Escher's work can be. It does rely a lot on figure-ground relationship. And what's interesting is there are people that are involved in design today, be it design of houses or design of clothing, that are using some of these principles when they design things for human consumption. They might be able to use certain light and patterns to make something look bigger or smaller. In a way, they're putting a practical use to these illusions for the most part. So we're going to talk about the theoretical explanation of illusions. And some of this might sound a little familiar. We're going to talk about Gestalt. And Gestalt, for the most part, it emphasizes how we organize incoming stimuli into meaningful perceptual patterns. And this is because of the way our brain is structured. If you remember kind of what the Gestalt psychologists were all about, it comes from the German word that means whole or form or configuration. And it basically it means that the sum is more, or the whole is more than the sum of its parts. It's believed that perception is based on innate factors built into our brain. So in a sense, it's kind of the nature side of things that our brain wants to make sense of the world that we live in. Whereas you can have learning-based inferences, this is a nurture kind of thing. This is the environment. And we're going to talk more about this towards the end, but it's basically getting into the fact that it emphasizes learned influences on perception, including the power of expectations, the context of what we're taking in, and the culture that we're from. So you have seen probably this figure ground illusion before. We've got the men that are descending the steps. And if you look closely, you might see the arrows that are going up and down. This is basically a figure ground example. The organization of the visual field into objects that would be your figure that stand out from their surroundings. And the surroundings are obviously the ground. Taking a look here, we have what looks like a nectar cube. And this is the closure. This is how we fill the gaps to create a complete and whole object. So we love this idea of being able to make sense of the world. And we have a tendency to try to make meaningful patterns out of things. And that's really what it's all about. So when we talk about a school of fish, as you see here, there's some questions. You know, it's easy to see a school of fish as a single unit, especially, you know, when it's all swirling around in the water. And that's kind of the gestalt side. But how do we pull together in our minds that separate stimulus elements seem to belong together? You know, when you look at a school of fish, you don't tend to look at one fish. And part of this is the principles that go along with the gestalt laws. So we're going to take a look at some of these perceptual grouping laws that are kind of known as the gestalt laws. And you've heard about some of these when you were in your intro class. The law is similarity, this idea that we tend to group similar objects together in our perception. So when I look to the right here at the diagrams, am I looking at you know, the items in the series of a row? So I'm looking at maybe all the boxes and then all the circles and then the boxes and so forth. The law of proximity, this idea that we tend to group things that are kind of close together, that nearness thing. So if we look at our sets of dots here, do we see it, the first example here, as just one unit? Or do we see this as being three separate units, kind of their own entirety? Continuity. We prefer perceptions of connected and continuous figures to those that are disconnected or disjointed. So when I look at maybe a figure like this, am I looking at it maybe in the terms of it moving upwards, opposed to maybe moving to the side? Okay. Common fate. We tend to group similar objects together that share a common motion or destination. So maybe the geese that are flying in the sky above us, if they're all kind of flying in the same direction, we have a tendency to group them as one. And the law of Prägnäs, this is the idea that the simplest organization requiring the least amount of cognitive effort is what we're going to see as a figure. And a great example is when you kind of read maybe the item that's in this box. Our brain has a tendency to kind of get rid of the things that don't make sense. So more often we're going to read this a bird in the hand rather than a bird in the hand, because it just makes more sense to get rid of one of the does. Or when we look at the rings for the Olympics, you know, how are we putting those together? Are we looking at it as one unit, or are we looking at it as five different circles? All right, moving on, we're going to talk a little bit about some other depth perception cues. And I want to talk about the visual cliff, which is something you might have seen before. This was developed by Eleanor Gibson and Richard Walk. And what that basically is doing is trying to see whether or not this young child would see the changes in patterns. And, you know, no baby would be harmed in this situation, but it's the idea that the tablecloth, the print on it, makes it appear that there's a cliff, and whether or not the baby would stay safe on the other side of that, or if the baby has no depth perception, whether or not they would just go across the plexiglass and, you know, not even worry about it. Binocular cues. This is the idea of using both eyes at the same time. This is what gives us our ability to see depth for the most part. Binocular cues, for the most part, this is the information taken in with both eyes. It aids in depth perception. Binocular convergence, which is something that your eye doctor always is looking for. This is the idea of like holding a pen in front of both of your eyes and then asking you to stare at it to see whether or not your eyes come together. In some cases, what they are trying to do is to see if your eyes can cross. The retinal disparity, this is like the flying sausage event. This idea, can you converge at a point right in front of you, and then what happens, or right behind you, and then what happens to the items in front of you? And supposedly, if you're looking at a wall and you put your fingers in front of you, you might end up with the floating sausage. So monocular cues, these are cues that are about information about depth that relies on the input of just one eye. So you talk about linear perspective. This is the parallel lines looking as they converge into the distance. And, you know, you can take the blocks here. We know that these are kind of the same length, but as they move off and converge supposedly at a point way, way, way in the back, it looks like that these lines are not necessarily exactly parallel, okay? But we know that they are. Interposition, objects that block the view of other objects must be closer. So for the most part, when we talk about our ponies here and how they're blocking maybe the view of the mountain in the back, we assume that this one is much, much closer. Relative height, objects that are seen as smaller and higher in relation to the items are closer. So yeah, we see this guy, maybe he's being closer, but there is an illusion here that might make him seem like a giant. Texture gradient, we can see more details in the texture of objects that are closer. Things that are further off have a tendency to be a little more blurred. And then relative size, larger objects appear to be closer. So in the case of this young boy who looks like he's holding something in his hand, which is kind of, you know, not necessarily possible. That's why relative light, objects that cast a shadow have more of a 3D appearance than those without. Brighter objects appear to be closer than darker ones. So learning-based inferences. This is kind of the other side of things. This goes back to 1866, and Hermann Helmholtz, who was kind of one of those fathers of Gestalt psychology. Anyway, it's the view that our perception is based primarily or shaped primarily by the learning or experiences that we seem to take in throughout our life, rather than some kind of innate factor that's kind of wired into our DNA. So we use things such as context. This is formed expectations about what persons, objects, or events you're likely to experience. It's hard to recognize outside of this expectation. A perceptual set, this is the readiness to detect a particular stimulus in a given context. So you focus your alertness for a particular stimulus in a given context. So with either one of these illusions that you see here, sometimes we talk about whether or not you see the young lady or the old hag, or in the case of Barack Obama, which one is proportionately the correct image. And, you know, you might have to look for some really weird cues, perhaps maybe the way the eyes are looking or the shape of the mouth. If you happen to want to look at this, you might have to flip your head upside down so you can see which one is which. All right, the Ponzo illusion. Which bar is longer when we look at either one of these, or the length of the line? Or are both for the same length? Well, the research shows that responses to these figures depend really on that cultural influence. It kind of goes back to what we mentioned before about, you know, the people of South Africa with Richard Gregory's research. If you come from a culture where things are a little more circular, you might not necessarily fall prey to this. Linear perspective. This is favored by people who live in cultures that have 90-degree angles, long buildings, railroad tracks, long sections of tracks from roads, all of that. Thank you very much.